يعني المستقبل يبقى في غموض. كل يوم يحدث حدث جديد، لا نعرف المصير، يعني يبقى خوف.
There's civil war in the Middle East everywhere.
When you lose everything, you need everything.
You will not know who will try to kill you. Everybody fighting everybody.
Why people have to pay and why the borders closed?
I'm always worried about this point and my body is very tired.
I don't know what would be my future and what is my destiny.
It was a very tense environment. People were extremely, extremely desperate.
These children are coming all the way from a war-torn country.
It was not because I needed money. I left because I needed my life.
Over here, we have the boat houses. So the wooden backboards are the backs of the boats, and the tarps on top are the actual rubber from the boat, so it keeps it waterproof. We're reusing the materials. And over here, you'll see one of the engines that the boats come in on. Because of the amount of people on the boats, they can't really be reused. Plenty of times I've had to swim around the back of the boat and, you know, turn the engine off. Hey.
Lesvos took about 650,000 refugees out of the 1.1 million that entered Europe. So as you can imagine, it was, you know, pretty crazy here. And there needed to be a space for vulnerable refugees. You know, anyone who's has any illnesses or they're sick or pregnant, disabilities, LGBT. The worry about PICPA being closed down is that there is no official or unofficial space that looks after vulnerable people. So essentially what the municipality and the government are saying is that the vulnerable people are going to be put along with everyone else. That's the scary thing, because there are people here with mental health conditions, people here who have lost whole families out at sea.
I had a normal life, beautiful house. I'm a student. Imagine if this will happen for you. I don't like to happen with you, but imagine. Any person imagine if he has anything and lost everything. My mother, she can't take care of me. She's very tired, not like before. My father can't walk now, and he can't walk by border. The only way to bring him here, to buy land. See, he always cried on the phone, told me, I missed you, I missed you. When he cried, I cried with him. I don't know how I have to do.
I was not playing to make people happy. to listen to me. I was playing like I'm trying to cry with my music. All the way, everywhere. I was playing in the train, when we were sleeping, when we were staying somewhere. And even the police was coming to listen to me because they said, oh, why are you playing? I said, this is the Kurdish instrument. Sometimes I feel shame, I'm here. Your brothers dying, sacrificing themselves. But you are here and asking to someone helping you. When I was being arrested two times, they were asking me, they said you're working against the French government. Well, it's not true. And they said to me, why you try to helping people to settle them in the camp? So I said, if I'm not doing that, who will do that? This is our office, I'm opening. He was 17 and he tried to go to UK on the axle of lorry. He was stayed on the axle and he died. For how long we have to sacrifice into crossing the border?
There is one of the kids, and he's a 15 years old boy. We are going to meet him in hospital because he's shot by plastic bullets from the police in his head. So we are going to meet him and see how is he.
The police were coming to me and they were coming to me. They were coming to me. They were coming to me.
He said when we were trying to go to England, so we stand there for the tracks come, and suddenly a small police car come, and after a big car come, and they're starting firing in us, kind of bullets, it's come in my head. Then I say I not understand what happening with me, and I was bleeding, and it was smell gas, yeah. Here I started a restaurant. I was a representative for Afghan community here in the jungle. Then I see there is a lot of kids that they have problem in here. There was about maybe 500 and 600 Afghan kids under 18. They don't have clothes, they don't have someone to talk with their language, someone to give them good information. So I start this restaurant, this kids cafe. Now they can stay here. This is a safe place. We can say a safe place more than anywhere in the jungle for the kids.
It's a little bit like a sort of home from home as much as possible, where they just come and sort of hang out. It's normally packed with loads of the unaccompanied minors. They've made lots of friendships. It's a really kind of nice space where they all come and play pool and watch telly and joke with each other and eat. So we try to show the kids different authorities, like Red Cross come regularly and the psychiatrist from the MSF comes, and so just introducing to people where they might be able to go if they need any help.
Right now they become like friends, like a family, and they're trying to give information and helping each other.
There are 1.4 million Syrians living in Jordan. So this country really is in need of help, but I've just been amazed and bowled over at how generous they've been, opening their doors to these millions and millions of people in need.
كان الأدوات قديما الأدوات يصنعوها من القش من قش القمح والشعير فينسجوا فيها أوعية هاي واحدة من الأوعية اللي مخصصة لوضع الخبز، يعني هيك هونية هون نحط خبز. هذا جرن الكبة، كل بيت المفروض يكون فيه لصناعة الكبة، يحطوا القمح واللحم ويدقوه بهذا الشكل. طبعا هذا كله مشان يعني بس حفظ الهوية السورية يعني.
Staff here, they are Syrians. When I say staff, I mean we call them officially volunteers, teachers, case managers, facilitators, all the people who provide immediate support to children.
The first thing we try to make the children forget the past, forget the war, forget the blood, and you know.
في لما جيت على مخيم الزعتري عانيت من صعوبات كبيرة. بسبب كانت الأوضاع صعبة في بداية المخيم ما استطعت أكمل دراستي، انقطعت عن الدراسة لمدة سنة بين الدراسة بسوريا والدراسة هنا في الأردن، بس الحمد لله رب العالمين قدرت بعدين أكمل دراستي وأتوجه على المدرسة.
نحاول أنه نساعد البنات الطالبات حتى ينسوا الآلام المعاناة في الحرب ويشعروا بسعادة وأمان.
أول شيء حلمي أني أرجع سوريا، ثاني شيء أني أحقق أحلامي أني أكون صيدلانية، أكمل دراستي وأطلع صيدلانية.
قررنا نغادر أملاً أنه ما نتأخر وإن شاء الله نرجع في أقرب وقت، ولكن لاحظنا أنه الحالة عم تتطور للأسوأ، يعني توقعنا أنه نذهب 10 أيام فقط ونرجع مباشرة.
These refugees 5 years ago when they came here, this was a desert, you know, and then this camp grew organically. Organizations coming, providing different supports, and it grew.
They came to the camps hoping that they're here on a temporary basis for perhaps 6 months max tops. But now they've been here for more than 3 years now. So it's really disturbing to see that day by day, they're losing their hopes.
I was crying every night whenever I saw the news. I thought, I got to get myself there. I'm a teacher. So I started to provide tables and chairs for children and to do some work with the children. And the children, as soon as they saw the tables and chairs, they shouted, school, school. Just before I left, I promised that I was going to come and open a school for them. And here I am. We have 440 refugees, Afghans mainly, and right now we're teaching a bit over 100 children a day. Salam, what you playing? You're playing cards. I think a lot of the parents who just arrived at the camp, they don't know that the school exists. And every day we're getting new students, between 3 and 5 students every day.
I've got this group of 6-year-old boys. They've obviously been through like a lot of trauma and they had a lot of pent up aggression and they were just like strangling each other literally. And you're just thinking like, what am I gonna do? And now just from 1 week of classes and schooling, and you know, they come in and they say salam and they shake each other's hand and they might have got out their book ready to color.
It's not just setting up a school and providing them with education, it's allowing the refugees to run their own school in the end. We're giving them the infrastructure.
We're trying to integrate the community, and we have a principal who is a refugee.
در امی سال که 2015 میگن از ما سال 1394 میشه. امی سال در آخرای سال مرا به حساب باز هم طالبا به حساب اختار دادن که تو به حساب وظیفه را اعلام بده تو امرای دولت کنم رابطه داری چی گپ است. ولی من وظیفه را به حساب اعلام نکردم. یکی از روزا طرف های شب بود می رفتم طرف خانه در دم رای مستار شدن من از موتر پایین کردن یک موتر خودم شخصی داشتم گفتم این کار که تو به حساب گفته بودیم رها نکردی چرا؟ گفتم چون خدمت به وطن است ما وظیفه ماست که به حساب خدمت بکنیم به حساب وظیفه گفت نه به دولت کار میکنه از من کدام گپ هست خب اینجا گرفتن مرا مورد لطکوب قرار دادن
How are you, Tamin? Yes, salam. Tamin is a very precious member of the community here.
Hello.
She's my favorite baby.
We have a very nice life in Afghanistan. Nice house, nice room, nice car, everything we got that. But unfortunately, I want to stay alive. I want to stay alive with my family. I want to support my family. But unfortunately, we can't do it here.
I am here with my entire family, my mom, my parents, my Down syndrome brother, my wife, and my beloved newborn son, Mustafa. We were five, but thanks God, but we are now six. I'm gonna show you my mom, my parents' tent. This is my parents' tent, and he is my brother. He lost his eyes, so he's Down syndrome and blind and suffering with this heat. She's my mother. She is teaching in school voluntarily here. So here is all the tents that the families are living here. All of them are full. So I left a country that is not secure. So that was my motherland. I would love to live there, but the situation comes something I said that let's leave.
طبعا في البداية طلعنا بسوريا كان بسبب الأوضاع الصعبة كان هناك قصف دائما قصف مدافع أحيانا اقتحامات اعتقالات يعني الحياة تقريبا شبه معطلة صارت ما في دراسة ما في حياة نظامية دائما في خوف في رعب من المجهول.
The major reason I left my country is my minority. Like I'm a minority in Pakistan. And like I belong to a province which is called Balochistan, and that province is in the situation like same like Kurdistan, because we are divided in three countries. Like one province is in Afghanistan, one province is in Iran, and one is in Pakistan.
أنا طلعت من سوريا مضطراً مش مختاراً يعني قاومت إلى آخر نفس لحتى ما أطلع بس لما تعذر استمراري يعني صار استمراري في سوريا يعني اني انا يعني اقرب الى الموت من الحياه يعني ما ظلش في قدامي فرص نجاة يعني.
You know there is in Afghanistan war there is two groups. One side is government, one side is Taliban. If you work with any one of them, you have problem with another group. If you work with Taliban, you have group problem with the government and American troops. They come and they bombing your houses, your village, and your people. If you the same, you work with the government, the Taliban do the same.
I was traveling from Logar province to Kabul that I got attacked there with a magnet bomb. There were four in the car. Me and the driver and two more to the back seat. Five, one more to the back of the car. So when the car exploded, I came out this position from the front glass car. So I break the glass. So with my head, you can see the statues, the scars here. With my this hand, from here to here, my hand was totally cut. I've seen by my own eyes, my blood was pumping the blood like water. It was going. Yes, and here, this part, see? I have a scar in my leg too, in my shoulder. So three of them were dead. Except me and the driver. We did survive.
It was 1250 Syria before the war. I was a student in university, Damascus University. It's so famous, it's so old, it's beautiful. I have exam, the last exam in the season, not in the year. I was waiting for my friends, they study biology. I study law. Yes, I was waiting for them. After that, the explosion is bombing, and I saw my friends flew in the air. I shocked, and after that I found training. I woke up in the hospital. I couldn't walk after that. They make for me every test and everything. They said my brain is normal, spinal cord is normal. We don't know what happened to you. It's very rare condition. After that, I was so sad, so tired. I entered in depression.
unfortunately, I work in a security company in Afghanistan. Unfortunately, one of the day, they kidnapped my son. Before I got three babies, right now I have two. My first son's name was Anil. Anil, they kidnapped our outside our house, they kidnapped him, and they called me. You come here. If you didn't come, we kill your son. We're talking together with my family, with my father and mother and brothers. They called me again. Tamim, do you want to come or no? You don't have time. Just 1 hour you have time to come. And if you don't come, we will kill your son. Again talking with my family, how can I do, father? What can I do? What's your idea? They called me again. He said, this is, you can find your son. Your die son, he was dead, not alive. You can find outside your house. When we go to check inside the pocket, that was very, very bad. They all cut his neck and they put him in water. He was dead.
So finally I said, enough is enough. I need to live with my family. I don't want to die.
If there's any choice, you are not able to make a choice. Because people fighting to keep their life of family, of your friends, of your relatives.
In my belief, I think God created us on this earth to live, not to die. Not to withdraw from it. So we should try our best to continue our life, to save our children.
The same before was the same like Adil. He's three here, and that time Anil was three here in Afghanistan.
This camp was a response to a gap that was left by the authorities here. So the arrivals were so much that they were overflowing from the Moria compound onto this hill. So a whole bunch of independent volunteers set up a camp here, providing shelter, food, water, dry clothes, medical supplies. People can come and get advice on asylum claims, they can get advice from lawyers, they can get any type of information they need.
So I have been 5 months as a volunteer, and I started my volunteer work on the very first hour I arrived in Moria camp.
He was so keen to get stuck into the work around here. You know, he came and he was like, cool, what can I do? How can I help?
Because I'm a human being, I have a personality back home, and I wanted to keep that personality. So I insist of sleeping in a camp and asking, like begging for some food, begging for some clothes. Why don't I help people?
This camp, as of today, is closing officially. This is because of the new EU-Turkey law, which has criminalized boat arrivals, and the inside Moria camp has turned into a detention center. And I think that's losing a lot here, because I mean, this was a happy place of exchange between volunteers and refugees, and an environment where these refugees can you know, almost help themselves and build up their own resilience. It kind of gave them, you know, some sort of semblance of control and dignity back. You know, the authorities at no kind of level, you know, show any sort of indication to work with us or to acknowledge that, you know, that they are leaving these gaps which we are having to come and fill.
I mean, the military have taken the camps over. They're under-resourced, understaffed, under-financed. They also have a different approach, not necessarily a very human approach. That's going to mean that the vulnerable people that are in this camp are going to be put into the same kind of places without anyone thinking about their, you know, their mental health or their well-being in general.
At the moment, if I go for my asylum, they will detain me and they will send me to Turkey back. And if I go to Turkey, I believe they will ask Turkey to deport me back to Pakistan and they will arrest me and maybe kill me.
Unfortunately, I don't know my future here. Then some people have money, they are giving by smuggler to the other best countries. You know, the situation of Greece is not good. This. We can't find work here. We can't stay alive here.
الوضع بأسنا كتير سيء، في ناس عم تنام بالشوارع، يعني أنا حظي كتير حلو إنه قدرت أمن مكان نام فيه ولو مكان عشوائي يعني. اللاجئين بيجوا من الجزر وبيبعتوهم على العاصمة بدون ما يأمنوا لي المأوى. بيكون عندهم مقابلة أو شيء بيعطوهم خيمة ينصبوها بالشارع، يعني الوضع سيء على كل العالم.
محتاجة أرتاح. محتاجة استغل أنا وطفلي ووضعي وضعي الصحي. عم بالشوارع كنا عم بنام أو عم ننام بالشوارع ما عم هيساعدونا.
من مكان لمكان لا بيت لا سكن ننام على الأرض. أكل ما في للأولاد. دكاترة ما في عندي 2 مرضانين من أولادي. ما في حكمة لهم ما في رعاية ما في شيء.
At this moment. I don't talk about everything. I need just security, safe, peace, normal, some food, water, tent like this. Even we are in 21st century. It's shame when you ask about food and water. It's shame for humanity.
فتهريب من الداخل للحدود التركية أمر صعب يعني ومخاطر كبيرة من محافظة حماة لإدلب للمناطق اللي بتسيطر عليها الفصائل متشددة النصرة.
Hiding from police, walking in mountains, walking in forest, walking in desert, then having a taxi, going in the trunk with 5 people, 4 people in a trunk, 15 people in a car.
I don't have wheelchair and I can't bring wheelchair because the wheelchair will make sounds and the Turkish army will hear the sound. So my brother's friend, he carry me.
سافرت أنا لحالي سافرت أنا أولادي لحالي ما معي حدا يعني ما حد ساعدني أنا كنت عم دافع عني وعن أولادي.
My wife was pregnant 7 months. She didn't eat almost for 24 hours whenever we were crossing from Iran to Turkey. I was almost to lose my wife.
I'm stuck in Turkey about 2 weeks in a refugee camp. It's about 2,000 people in small building. People sleep in the toilet.
The journey itself is very stressful, you know, with the smugglers and the actual physicality of the journey, being on a boat with 70, 80 people, you know, rough seas.
And the people were sitting here, like 59 people. The boat was jumping on the water and turning the boat back to the Turkey and just playing with us.
One of my shocks was all these kids who were so scared, coming out of the water, so scared. I thought, like, all these children, I'm not going to be able to swim when they're adults.
We arrived on the beach and we could see that there was a boat coming. as we were out in the water, we couldn't actually see it because it was very dark. And it went silent, and then we just heard all these screams, harrowing screams from like children and mothers. As we were about to swim out and take a look, we kind of saw the boat coming through the darkness. It was kind of tilting towards one side, the water was coming through. And you know, we managed to get the boat on the shoreline with all the other volunteers. He picked up a child by the leg upside down who was trapped underneath all the people, and he didn't look conscious.
You know, they put him down and the doctors went around him and you know, performed CPR as best they could.
He was so young and so small, and you know, there's a lot of people crying, a lot of people were upset.
My friend who speaks Arabic, she was, you know, speaking directly to the mother and really trying to calm her down. And I remember, because I was just kind of, at this point, I was standing there, you know, the doctors were with the boy over here and my friend was with the mother over here. And, you know, I mean, I was completely helpless in that situation and I felt completely useless in that situation.
You know, having nights like this continuously, it takes, emotionally, it takes it out of you, and yeah, it's an extremely difficult situation.
And the boy survived, luckily, because the ambulance came and he got taken to Athens and he survived.
It's a strange situation because these people, they're coming, they're escaping war and oppression. Sometimes boats come in and people are really happy, you know, they feel like it's their new life starting and everything has been put behind them, but, you know, little do they know that they get to Europe, they're not made, you know, they're not very welcome, and they actually have probably some very hard times ahead of them, and a lot of them don't know.
Coming into Piraeus port and seeing thousands of people sleeping on the floor, pregnant women, old people, with nothing. Nothing, hardly anything, no water, no food, anything.
They've often walked to the border at night time, single file, carrying elderly and injured.
I wasn't have anything. No money, no clothes, no food, no home. I lost my passport, no documents.
تركت رفقاتي، تركت أهلي، تركت مدرستي اللي هناك اللي كنت أحبها كثير.
My life, my friends, my family, my country, my people, my respect.
My mom is there, my brothers are there.
أنا متزوج، عندي طفل، عمره سنة وثمان شهور. أجبرت يعني إني أطلع وأتركين.
ما ضل عندنا شيء يعني بيوتنا راحت أهلينا راحت ما ضل شيء.
I lose myself. I lose my really. I lose myself. That's all I can tell you. I really lose myself. I don't talk about money because money go and come. But I lose myself.
الشجر، البيت، الأقارب، الجيران يعني فقدنا أحباء كثير في سوريا. وهذا لا يعوض.
So I just got an SMS saying that Sikander had been arrested. The police had come and arrested him. The police had just come in and sort of raided the restaurants. I think probably as an excuse. Not very happy about the jungle being here, would like to demolish it, and they don't really have very much power to do it at the moment, so I think it's a health and safety issue being used to, well, intimidate people. They arrested a lot of the shopkeepers, took away the stock, and they actually took all of the food out of the kids' restaurant and arrested Sikander. So.
So basically we're having a demonstration about the situation here on the island and the way that they're kind of detaining people.
everyone's just coming together. Everyone's pissed off, really, at the fact that the way the situation's being dealt with. No one really knows what's happening, or you know, who's getting moved where or who's getting moved when, and the people have rights, and it's not just about complaining about the situation and what it's like in there. It's also about, you know, recognizing that they do have rights and that those rights aren't really being, that they're not really being given to the people.
If you have family in Europe, you have the right to ask for family reunification. If you are from Syria, Iraq, Eritrea, Bahrain, Swaziland, or Central African Republic, you have the right to ask for relocation.
Today, police come, they arrest me, and I go to police station, and they are asking, you're doing business? I said, no, I'm not doing business, and I'm just helping the minors, the underages, and I give them food. Yeah, they come here, and they arrest some restaurant owners and some shop owners, and anything you had in your restaurant and your shops, they take it, and they, I don't know, they put it in garbage. They completely clean it, my restaurant, take everything. People come and sit in the restaurant, they charge their telephones, they eat here. And from the shops, they're buying their stuff, what they need. Right now, if they're not shops, they're not restaurants, they will go to the city. And in a crowd, they make a crowd in the city, and again, make problem for the city people, I think. It was better to have your shops and restaurants.
It's supposedly a place for the kids to feel safe, and then when there's fights or police raids and things like that, the feeling of kind of powerless, really, when you're trying to protect them, and in fact, you know, you can't do very much, really. We're doing like a tiny, tiny bit, and a lot more needs to be done.
They have no idea what's going to happen to them. Sometimes people leave, they go off to the border and try and cross. And then they come back, they have to come back. So we meet again, and I hear more stories.
None of these people that I've spoken to have any idea of when they're going to return. There is no visible silver lining to this, absolutely.
ما كان خروجنا لأوروبا هدفه مادي بالأساس يعني. هدفنا ندور على وطن حر يحترم الإنسان. نعيش بأمان. نعيش نحن وأسرتنا بأمان. هذا الهدف الأساسي.
إني ألاقي مستقبل نظيف لأولادي. إنهم يدرسوا ويكملوا دراستهم. يعيشوا بأمان. يعني نحن هربنا من تحت الضرب. ما هربنا مشان نقعد هون نحن بمدارس. مشان نقعد ببيوت مع أولادنا. نأمن لهم مستقبل أحسن. مو بمدارس على الأرض عم ننام.
A lot of these people have skills, you know, they're lawyers, doctors, teachers, civil engineers. Use these people's skills so that collectively we can move forward together and actually, you know, make our own situations better.
I will work in restaurant, I will work in municipality, I will just broom the roads. But I don't want charity. I will work. I will make my life much more better. I will work for my lovely son. I am his father. I have to support my son. Why should he have to be left under these circumstances that I don't want to be?
When you read about this stuff and when you look at the images in the media, it's so much kind of like victimization, and the pictures are always of people who are so desperate, and that's obviously how you engage people, but they have so much more agency than the media affords them, and I think that's been for me the most sort of striking thing about it.
I want to be judged in the United Nations. If all the doctors in the world, they told me you can't walk, I will fight to walk. And always in my dream, I don't see myself in the wheelchair. I always see myself walking, and I will walk and become judged.
My mom was like encouraging me. She said, because you talk in English, even if it's not well, good, but you can help. Helping your people. It's like to comfort myself, because I was filled shame all the way that I'm coming to escape. To not fighting, but here helping with people, it is the same, like you fighting again for your rights.
The kids, when they tell me, Sikandar, you're a nice man, you're helping us. As you will see after when the kids come here and they give me a hug and they will tell me, thank you very much. So this has given me energy to work more.
the most proud thing when I'm dreaming is I feel like, come on, today I helped this much people who were really needy. And maybe I don't change my clothes for weeks, but I give people clothes, which is really proud for me.
So this was nothing. And now it's looking like it might be something. It's not much yet, but it's a fig tree. Just in a few months we've watered it, surrounded it with seagrass and whatever mulch we can find. And now yesterday we made the tire garden. And that's going to be a teaching garden. And if you look around the camp, you'll see all these tire gardens.
Most of people here send their children to school day by day. Every day you can see fathers, mothers take the children to the schools and wait them outside the school to take them back to the house. And they hope to build another future for Syria, better future. By education, by culture, by degrees, by teachers, doctors, this thing will build our Syria. This is what the people believed in here.
One teacher told me, you know what is my biggest wish here? And I expected something, you know, like some specific kind of training or some topic that she needs support with. She said, I would like to see green trees. It's been 3 years that I'm here and I haven't seen green trees. She is a psychosocial worker. So, you know, she needs to provide the psychosocial support to students, you know, and she herself, her biggest wish is to see green trees.
We didn't imagine that the circumstances or the situation will be in like this way. Nobody knows in Syria, well, it's gonna happen. What's gonna happen now?
The Middle East is a place where there's still a lot of war, and there's gonna be a lot of displaced people, and they're gonna try and get somewhere safe. I think they're gonna still try and come by the sea. If that fails, they'll find different, probably more expensive ways which benefit the smugglers.
Every person who has a human heart will say you deserve asylum. Wherever, I don't care whether it's Germany or Greece, I don't care either it's France or Sweden. What I care, I should be under the protection. And at a point, I could call my family. Instead of running every 6 months in Pakistan, they should be in a safe place with me.
As I see it, it's day by day getting worse, you know. It's day by day getting worse. There's a lot of refugees in here.
How will it unfold? It will depend on changing the culture in our politics.
Until the proper solution is put in place or something that works, this is not going to stop.
Jordan is doing a fantastic job given the kind of economy that Jordan has. So why is it that bigger countries, more progressive, more economically well-off countries, why can't we devise better solutions?
You know, whatever happens with the refugee crisis, they will be okay because they can look after themselves. They're discovering resources in themselves they may have never had to find. So there's going to be some amazing people come out of these camps in the end.
What's happening in the Middle East is not related to the Middle East, it's related to everybody. It's even related to UK because we're sharing humanity.
حلمي أمن مستقبل منيح لأبني أولادي اللي بدهم يجوا. هذا حلمي إنه مستقبل منيح له يرتاحوا ما يتششنطوا مثلنا ما يتبهدلوا مثل ما تبهدلنا وصار فيهم ما يصير فيهم هيك.
يعني يبقى خوف من المستقبل ولكن نتأمل لما ننظر إلى الأطفال تعود لنا الابتسامة.